thank you so much for coming. It's always a pleasure to talk about film noir. I want to first define film noir very briefly before I show you clips from the work of three seminal Austrian directors who emigrated to Hollywood and had an enormous influence on the noir style. Film noir is a descriptive term for a certain kind of crime and suspense film that started more or less in the early 40s and faded out more or less in the late 50s and early 60s. You know, historians like to date things precisely, January 1st, 1941. It doesn't work that way. So let's say early 40s to late 50s, that's the general framework of what has now come to be called classic noir. Why a French word to describe an American film style? Very valid question, which I'll now proceed to answer. When the folks were making the films, some clips from which you're going to see tonight, and you would have said to them, oh, that was a wonderful film noir that you made that was released last week, none of them would have known what you were talking about. They were not making film noir. They were making what would have been called crime movies, thrillers, psychological thrillers, suspense films. Film noir was named by a group of French critics after a collection of American movies not shown during the war from 41 to about 45, because as you know, France was occupied, Paris was occupied. American films were not allowed to be screened. After the war, a group of American films was released in Paris. And as you may or may not know, the French are usually not too crazy about us, but they love our movies. And so the French critics, starved from having seen any American films for those years, went to see this group of released American films, and they, very vigilant about our work, said, aha, there is a new tone in these American movies. They are much darker than the usually upbeat Hollywood product. We will name them film noir, dark film, also black film. That's the origin of the term. Film noir did not become a common descriptive until in America until the 70s and 80s. And then it's only grown larger and larger. I'm on the board of directors of the Film Noir Foundation, and we host film noir festivals around the country. And they have grown in size. There is a core of hardcore, what we call noiristas. They love film noir. They're great. Not all of them, but there are a lot of great films. We're going to be seeing today the work of three directors born in Austria, all of them Jewish, or in the case of Fritz Lang, part Jewish, all of whom had to emigrate to save their lives from Hitler's Germany and from the Anschluss, the annexation of Austria, in 1938, and you will recall that Hitler was Austrian. He annexed his native country in 1938, by which time Fritz Lang, Billy Wilder, and Otto Preminger had left Austria, terrified, running for their lives, literally, and had made a great success for themselves in America. All three directors made seminal film noir. At the time, suspense films, film noir in the light of history. We're going to be seeing excerpts from two crucial film noir by Billy Wilder, Double Indemnity, 1944, Sunset Boulevard, 1950. If you pinned me against the wall and said, what are the two greatest film noir ever made? I might answer with those two films I just told you. Billy Wilder as a director of noir beyond compare. Personally, I don't much like his other work. I don't like his comedies. Shoot Me Now, but I can look at Some Like It Hot, which people say is the greatest comedy ever made in America, and I sit there for 2 hours without smiling. That's me. And I do not like The Apartment at all. But people do like it, people do. But I love Billy Wilder's film noir. Fritz Lang came to America earlier than the other fellows and made a name for himself only in film noir. Billy Wilder branched out and did comedies and romantic comedies, and that was his specialty. Fritz Lang, only film noir, only. His only good films are noir films. When he did westerns, not very good, but why would an Austrian have a touch for an American Western? He wouldn't, and he didn't. And why did they cast him as a director of Westerns? One of the Westerns is with Marlene Dietrich. Talk about miscasting and misalignment, and it doesn't work. It's fascinating, but it doesn't work. And then the third director, Otto Preminger, is the one who I've done the most work on, and Preminger's best work, also not in noir, but in spacious, historical epics about institutions. Preminger made the greatest film ever made about American politics, Advise and Consent. Do you know that movie? Yeah. Fabulous, the best. He made the best film ever made about the American system of jurisprudence. Have you heard of Anatomy of a Murder? A superb film about the church called The Cardinal, the Vatican. Jewish director making a wonderful film about Catholics. Well, there it did work. And he made the seminal epic, it's one of my favorite films, and it is a beautiful work about the founding of Israel, Exodus. None of these have anything in common with film noir. So the directors had various temperaments, but everything that we're going to be seeing tonight is hardcore noir and very much to the manner born. What do they have in common? They all brought with them a sense of a historical calamity that had overtaken their lives. They ran for their lives from a government that had failed them. They knew what tyranny was. They knew what the absence of democracy and freedom was. And all of them, especially Preminger, but all of them, were enormously grateful for the freedoms that were afforded them in this country. The big sourpuss among the group, Fritz Lang, wasn't so crazy about us, and he left and returned to Germany. The other two would never have dreamed of going back to Europe. They became pure Hollywood citizens. So the first clip I'm going to show is from the canonic film noir, Double Indemnity. How many have seen that? Okay, now we're all of a certain age, let's be honest tonight. Will anybody admit to having seen it in 1944? When it was first released? We're not that old. We're senior citizens, but we're not that old. So when this came out, it created a lot of havoc in terms of censorship. It was very daring for the time, and no leading actors in Hollywood wanted to play the roles. It became, in fact, Fred McMurray's greatest performance. He didn't want to play the role because he said it would tamper with his image, and he was developing an image of the nice guy next door. He's not playing that here. He plays in this film the quintessential film noir antihero. And for me, it is what I'm going to say now is the essence of film noir. Fred McMurray plays an insurance salesman, a perfectly law-abiding citizen, just like you and me, who goes to sell an insurance plan and is very attracted to the wife of the house. And that begins his downfall. So noir is about normal, everyday bourgeois citizens who, through greed, lust, or mischance, slip into a criminal scenario. The first scene I'm going to show you is when he meets this attractive woman who turns out to be, in, again, a French term, you've heard the term femme fatale, fatal woman. a woman without a heart, a woman who kills for money, literally. Nobody wanted to take the part except for Barbara Stanwyck, who was very courageous. She was dedicated to the role, and she didn't care if the audience hated her in the part. Most actresses want to be loved. Barbara Stanwyck didn't need the love. She dedicated herself to the role. Boy, is she a tough cookie in this part. She is masked. She is wicked. Now, already I've said some things that might indicate that there is a strong misogynistic undertow in film noir. Yes, there is. These films are male nightmares. What happens when the male is unwary and unguarded? We're about to see.
Accident insurance?
Accident insurance? Sure, Mr. Dietrichson. Would you tell me what's engraved on that anklet?
Just my name.
As for instance?
Phyllis.
Phyllis, huh? I think I like that.
But you're not sure.
Well, I'd have to drive it around the block a couple of times.
Mr. Neff, why don't you drop by tomorrow evening around 8:30? He'll be in then.
Who?
My husband. You were anxious to talk to him, weren't you?
Yeah, I was, but I'm sort of getting over the idea, if you know what I mean.
There's a speed limit in this state, Mr. Neff. 45 miles an hour.
How fast was I going, officer?
I'd say around 90.
Suppose you get down off your motorcycle and give me a ticket.
Suppose I let you off with a warning this time.
Suppose it doesn't take.
Suppose I have to whack you over the knuckles.
Suppose I bust out crying and put my head on your shoulder.
Suppose you try putting it on my husband's shoulder.
That tears it. Eight-thirty tomorrow evening, ma'am.
That's what I suggested.
Will you be here, too?
I guess so. I usually am.
Same chair, same perfume, same anklet.
I wonder if I know what you mean.
I wonder if you wonder.
Okay, now, isn't that great dialogue, first of all? That's called hard-boiled dialogue, and that's a hard-boiled seduction. The two characters are speaking in the lingo of pulp fiction, raised to the level of art. It's based on a novel by James M. Cain, who also wrote Mildred Pierce and a story you've probably heard of, Postman Always Rings Twice. And the adapter, working with Billy Wilder, was Raymond Chandler. Do you know that name? He wrote a series of mysteries, the Philip Marlowe stories. So this is hardcore, hard-boiled dialogue. It's vernacular American speech raised to the level of poetry. I call it pulp poetry, pulp fiction raised to the level of art. And these two actors play it skillfully. They bat the dialogue back and forth. However, if you notice the lighting, did you notice the stripes on the wall behind them? Who noticed the lighting pattern behind them? Bars, like bars, exactly. The lighting, which is always dramatic in film noir. Film noir images are filled with shadows and stripes, yes, like prison bars, because the criminal plot is hatched, at least emotionally, in this scene. They're going to conspire to kill her husband to get double indemnity insurance. And he's a nice guy. If it could happen to him, it could happen to you or to me. And those film noir really sets up a kind of warning to the errant American male, stay at home, mind yourself, these films are deeply anti-sex. Sex is toxic and leads to death, as we'll see in this. This is near the last scene of the film, also meeting in the house. Are we ready, Joe? Can we move it? It should start. Again, in this scene, it takes place in the same living room, but the living room has become much darker, much more shadowed, much more of a sense of enclosure and entrapment.
Better than that, can't you, baby? Better try it again. Maybe if I came a little closer. How's this? Think you can do it now? Why didn't you shoot again, baby? Don't tell me it's because you've been in love with me all this time.
No, I never loved you, Walter, not you or anybody else. I'm rotten to the heart. I used you just as you said. That's all you ever meant to me. Until a minute ago, when I couldn't fire that second shot. I never thought that could happen to me.
Sorry, baby, I'm not buying.
I'm not asking you to buy. Just hold me close.
Goodbye, baby.
See what I mean? Sex and death are interconnected, eros and thanatos, as in the ancient Greeks. So the mise-en-scène, the look, the decor of that scene, doesn't it look as if they're almost underwater? It's so shadowed and dark. He closes the drapes. They are deeply connected, what the French call a folie à deux. She has sparked something mad in him, and he has allowed her to pursue her wickedness. So it's a dangerous liaison. They shoot each other at the end. You can see why the censors might have had trouble with this, and Paramount had a lot of trouble getting the film released. Once it was released, however, it was recognized as a work of art. And you can see the extraordinary performances. Barbara Stanwyck was nominated for an Oscar, but you don't get an Oscar playing a killer. At least you didn't back then. So she has this masked style, and he has a masked style. It's called the somnambulistic style of the 40s, as if the characters are acting in a kind of fever dream or waking nightmare. And film noir is very much about the American nightmare. It's also metaphorically a war film. Not literally a war film, but it's a film that reflects the anxiety of a nation at war. And critics have talked about film noir as war films allegorically and metaphorically, not literally, but subtextually. Okay, the next film, also from 1944, also a very famous film noir, Laura, do you know that? Who's seen Laura? Okay. It was turned into an unbelievably bad television drama starring Lee Radziwill, who just died. Did anybody happen to see that? And it ended her film career. She had two parts, and people said she's not an actress. You have to be good to play Laura, and it was played by Jean Tierney in the 1944 film by Otto Preminger. This is the climax of the film in which the killer is revealed. Notice every object has some kind of symbolic weight. the ticking clock, the gun that's broken. All of that means something. The mirror shots, times two. The shadows, times two. It's about doppelgangers and doubles in ways that I will explain.
And thus, as history has proved, love is eternal. It has been the strongest motivation for human actions throughout centuries. Love is stronger than life. It reaches beyond the dark shadow of death. I close this evening's broadcast with some favorite lines from Dowson. Brief life. They are not long, the weeping and the laughter. Love and desire and hate. I think they have no portion in us after we pass the gate.
Who's tailing Lydecker?
I was going to when he came out.
He left 5 minutes ago.
He didn't come out this way.
Must have gone out the back way. Come on, let's check.
They are not long, the days of wine and roses. Out of a misty dream, our path emerges for a while. Then closes within a dream.
That's the way it is, isn't it, Laura?
What?
You have heard the voice of Waldo Lydecker by electrical transcription.
Waldo, you've taken one life. Isn't that enough?
The best part of myself. That's what you are. Do you think I'm going to leave it to the vulgar pawing of a second-rate detective who thinks you're a dame?
That's intriguing. Don't you want to see the whole movie after seeing that bit? Isn't that good? It's terrific. The cinematographer, Joseph Lachelle, won the Academy Award that year. You can see why. The film is a symphony of a lighting technique called chiaroscuro, which is high contrast between light and shadow. It's an art history term that we film historians have borrowed. High contrast between light and shadow. You see it. Heavy shadows, and did you notice the projection of Lydecker, played unforgettably by Clifton Webb? Did you recognize him? Got an Oscar nomination for that performance and turned him into a movie star, improbably enough. But we see him times two. We see him and we see his very prominent shadow because he's playing a double character. He seems to be a man about town, a gossip columnist, a man of some distinction, but he's really a mad murderer. He has killed somebody he thought was Laura because he can't control her. So this film isn't so much about the femme fatale. She's lovely, she's not a femme fatale, but about the homme fatale, the crazy man. And some film noir about men who go off the rail, and this one does go off the rail. Did you notice that he breaks turns the gun? This is filled with such Freudian imagery, that's a Freudian image. Breaks the gun, the broken phallus. And this character's masculinity is under attack because he is an encoded gay character. In 1944, they couldn't say it directly, but it is played there. So he wants to control Laura, but his rival is this man's man. He calls him this dirty detective who's going to paw you, played by Dana Andrews. And they have a competition for Laura. So everything is, notice Laura in the mirror shots, Laura, at the beginning of the story, is presumed to have been killed. And then when she returns, it's as if she's come back to life, so she's time too. It was somebody else who was killed by mistake. So there are these patterns of duality throughout noir, of characters who are divided from themselves, or who are two people, the masked character and the real character. So that psychologically, very complicated. Laura has been called a salon noir, meaning it takes place among the world of the very rich in New York society. But it is really a psychological suspense story, second to none, based upon a very famous novel by Vera Caspary called Laura. Next, we're going to see two scenes from a 1945 movie by Fritz Lang, starring Edward G. Robinson and Joan Bennett. Edward G. Robinson plays a character somewhat like the Fred McMurray character. He is, and this film makes me very nervous, he is a fuddy-duddy university professor. He's very contained. He's very respectable. He's just sent his wife and children off to a vacation for the summer, and he is, so to speak, at liberty. Purely by chance, he runs into a woman whose picture he sees, his painting he sees in a window, the woman in the window. The real woman just happens to materialize next to him. That real woman is the beautiful and alluring, but dangerous, Joan Bennett. He should have said, nice to see you and good night. Instead, he gets involved, and this is what happens to the poor guy. This is the scene in which he becomes embroiled in the criminal scenario. Film noir always has to have a crime, or it's not a film noir. There has to be a crime, and we see the commission of the crime in the scene.
Ouch.
Oh, did you cut yourself?
No, but the wire broke. Have you something to cut it with?
Scissors all right?
Yes, I think that'll do. Who are you? My name is...
Frank! Frank, I'll listen!
I told you if you ever...
Stop that, you fool!
Fool, eh?
This is the follow-up to the next scene.
Thank you.
I won't see you again, I suppose.
For both our sakes, I hope this ends the whole thing completely and forever.
All right, then. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Beautifully shot, you know, beautifully designed. In the first scene, the murder scene, which happens quickly and by chance, he's visiting her. They've met outside the window of the art gallery, and he's gone back against his better judgment to her house. And a beau of her comes, and the beau is obviously enraged and jealous, and in self-defense, he kills the beau. But notice he kills him with a scissors that she gives him. And the scissors is meant to be not a masculine weapon. And that's making some comment about the professor himself. Did you notice all the mirror images in that apartment and all the reflections? Again, the character seen times two. It's as if the character entering the Robinson character entering that space becomes somebody other than himself. And so we often see him being reflected. When they dispose of the body, it's raining. Rain is essential in film noir. You don't want good weather in a film noir story. And my favorite venue, actually, for film noir festivals that I go to is in Palm Springs, California, which is gorgeous and beautiful, but I always tell them, you're the best city in America, but it's not the right place for film noir. The weather's too nice. So we want dark and rain and damp and cold. And that scene creates it. But also, did you notice all of the images of frames within the frame? You see the Joan Bennett character framed by the door, framed in the window, then you see her reflection in the glass door times two with the rain coming down, and there she is. A frame within the frame, she's the woman in the window, she is enclosed within the frame. The rain coming down, the rain slick streets, the shadows, and he says, I hope we don't meet again. There's going to be plenty of meeting. And boy, does he get into more and more and more trouble. But you know what? It was a dream. And at the end, after he wakes from his dream, he's in his club, a very stuffy club. He goes back to the art gallery. He sees another painting of a woman in the window. And a woman comes by, she is encoded as a prostitute, and he runs out of there as fast as he can. So that is the point of the film, to warn the unwary American male to watch himself. These films, and the French were very good about noting that, these films took the American hero off his pedestal. And over again in these film noir, males are compromised. They're not in their usual heroic position. The worst actor for film noir, he never did one and he couldn't do one, would have been John Wayne. You want an actor whose masculinity is vulnerable and assailable. John Wayne didn't play that. But Edward G. Robinson could do it, Fred McMurray could do it, and Edward G. Robinson in the next scene, even more dramatic, a 1945 film, again with Joan Bennett. He should have learned to stay away from Joan Bennett, except he made two of his best films with her. Scarlet Street, in which he plays a painter, like the professor, a man who's very repressed. He has a wife from hell. He works as a cashier. His life is one of routine. At the beginning of the film, he decides he's going to go home by a different route from the one he normally takes in his everyday routine. He goes one block out of his way, and who does he encounter? Joan Bennett and Dan Duryea in a straw boater hat. Is he in trouble? And terrible things happen to him, and at the end of the film, here is where he is, a Sunday painter, an unhappily married man, a cashier who steals from his job in order to support Joan Bennett's lifestyle. And this is what happens to him.
Johnny, Johnny. Oh, Johnny, Johnny.
Lazy legs.
Johnny, darling.
I'm here, baby.
I'm here, baby.
Jeepers, I love you, Johnny.
It's him. You were innocent. You were pure. That's what he killed in you. He's the murderer.
No, he's not. Not Johnny.
See, Chris? She loves me.
That's why you had to die. You're the one I killed.
Now she's mine, Chris.
You killed Johnny?
I'd like to see you cry.
Yes.
Why, he'd break every bone in your body. He's a man.
Kill him!
Stay away from Joan Bennett, Edward G. Robinson. What you just saw is a supreme example of a style called German Expressionism. And all three of our Austrian directors were trained in that style in their native country, in both Austria and Berlin, and they went to both cities, worked in Vienna and Berlin. And that was a reigning style of the time. German Expressionism, which goes back to the turn of the century, really. And that's a style which privileges subjectivity over objectivity. We're inside the mind of the character. We're hearing what he hears, and we're seeing the world from his own fevered and disoriented perspective. Expressionist painters and expressionist filmmakers and writers were working in a canvas of subjectivity and distortion. The expressionist does not paint the world as it is, but as he feels it. And since we're talking about Germany, the feelings were very dark and the colors were very heavy, and the depiction is of a nightmarish reality. And so that's what you've just seen, a nightmarish version of the character's circumstances. This character is doomed. He can't be arrested for complicated plot reasons. He isn't accused of the crime he does commit. He does kill Kitty, but he can't be arrested for it. Johnny was arrested and executed for the crime, so he's technically free, but he is tortured in his mind forever. And that sequence is a very famous example of expressionist technique. German expressionism, full-fledged in the way you just saw it, was not a popular American style. American audiences would reject too much of that, and all three of our directors, realizing that, had to control and tame the excesses of expressionism in their American work. This is Fritz Lang in the 40s. By the mid-50s, when he was making his last American film, Noir, there's almost no trace of his expressionist background. It was trimmed out of his work as being essentially un-American, almost suspiciously European. The next film is maybe the least well-known of the ones I'm showing you, Where the Sidewalk Ends. Did anybody see that? 1949, with two of Otto Preminger's favorites, Jean Tierney and Dana Andrews. Again, in this film, same story, a recurrent pattern. The character played by Dana Andrews is a law enforcement figure. He's a policeman, but he has a history of being a little overwrought and being rough on his victims or suspected guilty people. And he has some very bad luck in this scene. And this is the moment in which a law-abiding citizen slips into the other camp, becomes a criminal. And you see, he already begins to act and look as if he's guilty. Notice the Band-Aid on the figure here. So many images of male impotence or castration, literally or symbolically, over and over again in film noir. The American male taken off his pedestal, made vulnerable to the wicked woman. So many of the films tell the same story that it must have said, spoke about something deep within the culture, both during and immediately after the war, which is why I call these films, in quotation marks, war films.
Dead. You're lying. Scalise is trying to frame you, as you knifed him.
Go home.
Look, I'm trying to help you, Payne. Scalise and his boys are hanging a murder on you. They knocked him off to get their dough back after you left. Come on.
You aren't. No cop's gonna touch me. Stand up alone, then.
I'll stand up when I want to.
Get out of here. Get out!
Okay, buddy. Come on, let's go. Come on.
Dana Andrews, a good actor. Do you remember Dana Andrews? Very good actor. He never let you catch him acting. Very subtle. He can communicate a lot with just a little facial muscle or a reaction. He doesn't need a lot of dialogue. Both times the character is under fire when he realizes that he's accidentally and inadvertently killed this suspected criminal. And when he picks up the phone and doesn't know whether he's going to tell the truth or not, and he doesn't tell the truth, both times did you notice the camera moves in on him? And that movement in on the character suggests the psychological enclosure that's coming over him because of what's happened in the story. He's becoming a trapped and hunted figure, and for the rest of this film, this is a man in a disguise and in a sense trying to escape from what he did, and he can't. There is no way out, which is the name of another canonic film. Noir could have been the title of this film. No way out. And the camera moving up closely and pinning him against the wall is a very good indication of the claustrophobic mise-en-scène that runs throughout the noir canon. Okay, the last clip is from a film I suspect you've all seen, you certainly all know it, Sunset Boulevard. Who knows who's seen that? In 1950, did anybody admit to seeing it when it first came out? Because I did. I was too young to understand it, but I saw it. fabulous film, absolutely fabulous. It is so powerful an indictment of Hollywood that people often don't consider it a film noir, but it is a classic film noir. The Gloria Swanson character is indeed a femme fatale. She does commit a murder, and the young man who becomes her prey, a screenwriter who's a little too ambitious but having very bad luck and comes within her clutches, played unforgettably by William Holden. And in this scene, we see the two of them watching clips of herself as a young actress when she was a star, and of course it's Gloria Swanson herself as a silent screen star. But also, what's important in this scene is there is a voiceover narration, and that was often the case in film noir where there was a narrator in the text, and as in this film, the narration is told after the story has already happened. In other words, the narration is in the past tense. The story has happened, the narrator is telling us what has already happened. And that's another way of boxing in the characters and of limiting the agency or free will of characters in film noir. In film noir, characters are guided by fate or destiny with a capital F or a capital D. Characters don't have free agency. They're victims of bad luck, mistiming, greed, lust, and their own inner weaknesses and compulsions. They're not free agents. This film is narrated. Do you remember the first shot of Sunset Boulevard? What happens to William Holden? He's shot dead, and he falls face down into a pool. Then he proceeds to narrate the film. This is a film narrated by a dead man. The only time in the history of filmmaking, as far as I know.
They were silent movies, and Max would run the projection machine, which was just as well. It kept him from giving us an accompaniment on that wheezing organ. She'd sit very close to me, and she'd smell of tube roses, which is not my favorite perfume, not by a long shot. Sometimes, as we watched, she'd clutch my arm or my hand, forgetting she was my employer, just becoming a fan, excited about that actress up there on the screen. I guess I don't have to tell you who the star was. They were always her pictures. That's all she wanted to see.
Still wonderful, isn't it? And no dialogue. We didn't need dialogue. We had faces. There just aren't any faces like that anymore. Maybe one, Garbo. Those idiot producers. Those imbeciles. Haven't they got any eyes? Have they forgotten what a star looks like? I'll show them. I'll be up there again, so help me.
Tell how fabulous the film is just from that moment. She is the classic femme fatale. She's going to take this young man in her clutches. He's weak and vulnerable enough to allow him to do so, and she's going to kill him. And you see her monstrosity and her ferocity in that sequence, plus that glorious chiaroscuro lighting, the light shining on her face surrounded by darkness, very theatrical and dramatic lighting. It's one of the great film noir and one of the great films. Also, it can't be played anymore. That's why all of the actresses who did it in the musical, Sunset Boulevard, weren't really good. It has to be played by an actress who was a silent screen star. The art of silent screen acting is over. Gloria Swanson knew how to do it. Glenn Close, Faye Dunaway, Patti LuPone, all of the people who've performed this role in the musical aren't fulfilling the part the way Gloria Swanson did incomparably, and nobody alive can do it. It needs a silent screen star to enact the gestural language of the silent screen. The last silent movie was made a long time ago. It's an art that exists no longer. Talking about arts that still do exist, I'll ask myself this question. Film noir ended its classical phase in the late 50s. Do they still make film noir? Yes, absolutely. They're called neo-noir. They're in color. They're often in widescreen. They're modernized. The rhythm is different. Times change. Filmmaking techniques change. Audience taste changes. But there's still a taste for a good suspense film with noir qualities. The best of the recent crop of film noir, you might not think it is that, but it is, and it won the Academy Award a few years ago. Did anybody see No Country for Old Men? That was film noir, neo-noir. Didn't take place in a big city, it took place in the Southwest. The settings were different, the color was different, but the story structure, the emotion, and the psychology, very reminiscent of the classic patterns of film noir.